We have clear values in this vision. That must be adhered to.
Let me tell you. If you are going to be what we say you want to be, don't come and tell me what you think you need to be told. You actually must align with what God is saying. Hear what God is saying. And when you hear what God is saying, God will tell you what he's saying in this vision.
And in this vision, God has said, we are raising champions. And champions are men and women that can withstand pressure.
Hello?
Do you hear me, brethren?
Pressure.
Do you not determine whether we are going to be champions? How many of you remember the scripture that was read by that man from Kenya?
Where he said, we are actually pressed on every side.
Pressed on every side.
Pressure.
Let me tell you, if you read the men and women in the Bible that became champions,
they never became champions in a safe environment, in a comfortable environment.
They never became successful, things happening.
They went through stuff. And that's why Paul says, in all these things, I am more than a conqueror.
In all these things. So we need men and women that understand this vision.
This vision is to raise champions.
And it doesn't end there. It requires men that are going to transform others.
You cannot really go out and transform others
if you've not been transformed yourself.
Truly transform.
Truly change.
Because you will actually be theorizing, telling people you are transforming.
You're going to transform them.
When actually yourself, you've not been transformed.
And then I know transformation the way it is. I know where I come from.
Yeah. God picked me from the ghetto.
I had no idea.
So I know what transformation is.
I know what transformation means.
If God takes you from the dust,
picks you from the bottom to the lowest place and lifts you up and changes you.
From the poor of the poor.
When the poor used to call us poor.
That's where we come.
I remember a lady actually talking about my brother, says, you see, this one is Varumbo.
Yeah.
But when God picks you from there, there is a change.
I mean, some of you think I used to be an aggressive person.
I used to fight.
I mean, fighting was just second nature.
To find an occasion to fight.
Was normal life.
Dancing with my young brothers.
That was normal.
I was not afraid of being wounded. I don't know how many times I got wounded. Fighting.
But when God picks you up,
restores you.
Some of you say, I'm so humble.
The pastor says, I'm a very humble man.
My goodness. You don't know what God did.
God does things in people's lives.
He restores lives.
And raises you and causes you to sit with kings.
We're not qualified to be able to sit anywhere.
And God made it possible.
God made it possible. And a lot of people stand in awe. They wonder,
how did God do it?
How did it happen?
But God is able to do that.
And I believe there's an anointing in this place.
That takes the people that are taught to be noble, people who believe in this vision and say, God, I believe there's something that you are doing here.
And I will not miss it.
I will hang on to the vision and it will cause me to be lifted up like you've lifted others.
So we have a vision here.
And we need to understand this vision. And not just a vision, but there's a mission to it.
The mission is to go and transform families, communities, cities, and nations.
And we're not doing it on our own.
God spoke to us in Exodus 33. Moses says, if your presence does not go with us, we are not going anywhere.
If your presence does not go with us, this thing will not be fulfilled. This vision is not fulfilled by just trickery or craftiness of mind or intelligence or anything.
This vision, it's not by might nor by power,
but by my spirit.
Just like he said it to Moses, realize, yes, God, you have sent me to take these people. But how will I do it?
If your presence does not go.
So that's why we value the presence of God here.
Let me tell you, we cannot do anything without the presence of God. We need the presence of God desperately. And the presence of God requires men and women that worship.
And worship is not just singing all the time.
Worship is more than just singing.
You worship, but you also worship.
It includes even issues of giving.
Self-dedication, denial.
Fasting.
Giving up certain things for the sake of the kingdom of God.
Worship is key.
Where you begin to say, Lord, I will give up certain things.
I'll give up my pride.
I'll give up my ambitions.
I'll give up my position.
I'll give up my wealth.
In order to advance this vision.
I'll give up my time.
In order to make sure that this vision succeeds.
So there's a mission.
Taking the manifest presence of God to empower families and communities and cities and nations.
One of the things that will help us to understand this vision is that in this vision we are clear that we need men and women that understand what it is to commit to a vision.
The problem with the church today is that the church has five categories or types of members that are in there.
Five.
The lowest one that we have are what I call scavengers.
We are not government.
Even vouchers, scavengers travel and go to all sorts of places and eat in the streets, in the bins, anywhere, not discretion.
I don't go pinda kwese kwese. Ongo tenderera. Ashingo jiga. Avine kuti zvakaora. Avabvunze kuti zvakadi. just gets there, finds people eating whatever they're eating. Then man went out somewhere, just similar.
Wait a manuka,
one would go. Anunchka everywhere.
Scavengers.
Scavengers.
These are born again Christians
who totally shun any form of authority
and accountability.
Call them spiritual tourists. Papa,
when I put ice cream.
I'm going to ice cream. The next day, what got you?
My leftovers.
Okay, wimpy.
Because I'm going to go to Zara.
They shun accountability or responsibility. They are interested in what they can get. They don't care what kind of food they eat.
Day to day, they are vicious, irresponsible.
Do you ever have dumb children?
Rejected children, orphans, or abused ones?
They are like that because they were abused by different churches and they float from one place to another.
And as a result, they cannot connect with any vision.
They have no parents.
As a result, they have not been discipled by anyone.
And they go into a tantrum.
What's that?
They are like that.
Problem.
Kick out all over the place.
And we have members that are like that in our churches.
Suddenly you discover because of a small thing.
You know, they are born but never fathered or mothered.
They are told to find their way in life.
They survive by scavenging. One day
they have ice cream.
And the next day they have rotten leftovers somewhere.
And they eat dead things.
They look like Christians, but they're not quite there.
They fight over food.
It's a survival of the fittest.
They have no regular place where they go.
You have to stop, you have to move from being a scavenger.
You have to realize that you need to belong to a home.
That's number one. Number two is take away churches.
Take away.
Maybe one of the waiter.
But as soon as they disappear,
they don't want too many people to ask too many questions, to know too much about them.
They just come for the nice food. They've made it a special restaurant.
This vision is not a restaurant.
This church is not a takeaway.
I will not labor on those ones. I will take also the restaurant ones and the takeaway ones. And then the hotel ones.
I pay my fees. I pay my tithes. So these people must do what I tell them.
You just sit back and say, you see, I paid my thing, this place must be nice, they must make sure it's nice, or else I'll go to another one.
When they start asking, is the Mrs. the real Mrs.?
Don't get too involved in my life.
Panapa, Tinoda Kuziva.
Because we are raising champions.
We have to know.
If you are a small house, we want to know.
Because we have to restore lives.
We don't condemn you.
But when you come here, we empower you, we show you exactly, and then talk about Basira. Because we are talk about real issues.
Because you cannot be a champion when you are living a false life.
Because you are growing and you get to a certain level, when now he sees that you are at a certain point where you can make maximum mileage, then you now affect the whole church.
It's me, my champions, we are not going to be afraid. We will take people and help them in spite of what condition they came in.
It's not for us to condemn anybody.
Whether you were a murderer, whatever you did, here you are accepted.
And God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above.
But can walk in, it's not a hotel.
It's a home.
This is a home.
And in a home there are fathers and mothers.
And in a home there are responsibilities for everyone.
You are accountable. You just don't do your own thing.
You, you,
to a family. And if you belong to a family, whatever happens to you affects the rest of the family. You cannot live your own life.
When you have come to Christ, it's not I that live it, but the life that I live.
Oh my God. You died to self.
And you are committed to the body.
We accept you as part of the body.
You now belong to the body of Christ.
So whatever you do affects us.
You need to understand whatever you are doing is affecting us so much.
So in a home, you'll be trained. You'll be given responsibilities.
In my home, I tell my children, if you come after 10,
you're in trouble.
Yeah.
If you belong to church, except now, you are still part of this home.
This is what we do here.
We have values.
We tell our children, wake up in the morning, you make up your bed.
So in every home there are rules and regulations.
And who sounds my rules up next door?
So we have clear rules that we operate by
to fulfill a vision.
Each place has a vision to fulfill.
The reason why they adhere to certain things is because they are pursuing to fulfill specific visions.
But here we have a vision, and that vision is followed by certain strategies,
things that are put in place that will make us fulfill that vision.
And that's what we need. Each one of us to understand. There are responsibilities.
You pay your tithe.
You come to prayer.
You fast.
When a command is made, we fast on Thursdays.
It's not a suggestion.
Some people are confused.
And yet they want to become champions.
I mean, I'm really shocked.
How do you expect to become a champion?
When you are actually being clear, simple instructions.
Just lose it.
It's not even a fast day, a whole day.
Just go, breakfast, lunch.
That's what we ask on Thursday. And you come to prayer in the evening.
And you are busy saying you want to be a champion.
And you're waking up.
What kind of a champion are you?
Who's champion anyway?
The devil looks at you and says,
Poor guy, this one.
Because if he wanted to knock you out.
Because let me tell you, the benefits of the home will only come to you when you live according to the regulation.
Some of you dare not go out there and say, I'm from HPMI.
When actually you don't even obey some of the basic rules.
Your pastors tell you certain things. You think they are crazy.
You tell you certain instructions.
You treat them like nobodies.
Let me tell you.
Demonic forces know rank.
They know rank.
And they will not obey anyone who is not under rank.
Under authority, they will not.
You will be actually treated like children of Sceva.
You will be stripped and running naked.
But you won't bata bata.
Because you've not understood authority.
In every home, there is authority, there is rank, there is responsibility, and those things matter.
People who understand rank will not do anything to uncover themselves.
Don't ever think you can do anything without the cover of where you are operating from.
to do what you're supposed to do because of the anointing that God has placed. The assignment that you are supposed to do is related to the covering and protection that also God gives you. Not all of us are at the same rank. God puts certain levels of authority to certain people so that his body functions properly. And that his people are protected. And so that the army is effective. So you need men and women that understand authority.
Actually, I feel pity for people who do not understand authority.
Who do not understand rank.
Because they will struggle to fulfill the will of God.
They will not progress.
So we have a vision. My time is up. I haven't even touched the Lord.
My way.
Next week. Anyway, I'm a man under authority. So I will conclude.
Brethren, we have a vision.
And this vision is a big vision.
We are not a small church.
You need to understand that. My wife last week was saying we're a small church. We're not a small church.
We are a big church.
We are a big church. God has given us a very big vision.
And that vision requires men and women that are going to be disciplined.
That are going to make sure they are aligned.
They understand working in rank.
So that it will be fulfilled.
It needs a well-marshaled army.
People who stand in their place
and actually do what is expected of them without a struggle.
It requires the values that we have talked about, commitment and devotion.
And it requires humility.
We need to humble ourselves.
Even people that are going to see us, we're helping all other churches around here, these people.
We don't want to be known to be proud.
We're not promoting our name.
We're promoting the kingdom of God.
We need humble people.
Yes, people will praise you. People will say all sorts of good things.
That's not the issue.
We have a vision.
We are not doing anything for anybody to celebrate us.
We're doing it to fulfill the will of God.
So we have an assignment, we have a mission.
We have a task.
That must be accomplished.
And let's not lose focus of that.
Because when you're a soldier and you lose focus and you concentrate on things that are just the ordinary things that have nothing to do with the assignment,
then you will be entangled and you lose and you end up getting killed.
We don't want unnecessary casualties.
Casualties come because we are missing the vision.
But when you are focused on the vision,
you will not die.
You will not fail when you are focused.
This vision must come to pass.
God gave us this vision in an extraordinary way.
It was birthed in an extraordinary way.
And God has determined that it will be fulfilled.
And you and I must be partakers.
And let me tell you, the benefits that are around this vision are unbelievable.
And I've told you many times, You cannot be attached to this vision and remain small.
I am convinced.
You cannot be connected to this vision and remain small, struggling.
You cannot.
Because if God gives a big vision, then he needs people.
And those people cannot remain small whilst they're trying to fulfill a big vision. So that's why I refuse. None of our children can remain small. The least among us will be like David. The least among us.
Because the vision is big.
And it requires men and women that will open up and say,
God,
whatever you want to do with me, I am willing.
And when you fall into the hands of God, it's better to fall into the hands of God than into the hands of men.
It's better to be in the hands of God than in the hands of men.
And let me tell you, God will never allow you to fail.
Let's stand up together.
Praise be to Jesus.
Okay.
Thank you, Jesus.
Let's stand up together.
So we are starting a 10-day fast starting tomorrow.
Hello?
Kuneva food, Derek.
I know some people said it's the first time a headache.
Yeah.
Because you just want to go to Zungu.